You are watching DHTV, the television program service of California State University, Dominguez Hills.
Hi, welcome to California State University, Dominguez Hills. This is Political Science 335, and I'm Hamoud Salhi. For the next 15 weeks, we'll be meeting you on this channel. For those of you who are taking this class, it's a pleasure having you in the class, and the syllabus, assignments, and all those wonderful things that you expect to do while taking the class are on a blackboard for you. This class, this program, will help you get more information for your assignments and more so to understand international politics. For the large audience, this is your chance to express your views on specific topics, topics that are important in international politics, topics that you may have a view and you might want to express them on the phone. You can call us on the 800 number, 339-1193, or you could send us an email, and usually in the second section of this program, we'll have a guest. The guest will answer, if there is no guest, I'll answer the questions you have. But we welcome your comments, welcome your questions, and this is a way for Cal State Dominguez Hills to reach out to the community and be participant in the learning process. So this class, however, is part of the Applied Studies Bachelor's Degree Completion Program. Classes are broadcast live on this cable television channel and webcast on the internet each week. This spring, we are broadcasting four classes. Political Science 310, this is a Current Issues in American Government, a class, and it's offered on Tuesdays from 7 to 9 p.m. Then you have a Social and Behavioral Science 318, this is a Cultural Pluralism class. It is offered just before this class. It's a cool class, and on Saturdays from noon to 1:40. And then, of course, this class, International Politics, it's offered on Saturdays, 1:50 to 3:30 p.m. And finally, the Communication 300, Organizational Communications, and it's offered on Sundays from noon to 2 p.m. If you'd like more information about the Applied Studies Bachelor's Degree Completion Program, please visit our website at www.appliedstudies.tv, and you have a number there. It's 866-278-6789. So that's part, if you're interested in getting a certificate or a degree from in this, the Applied Studies, and this is what this class is all about. Okay, so we talked, what I'd like to do today, or what we have to discuss today, are a general overview of international politics and sort of introduce us to the major challenges that are facing American foreign policy, that major facing world politics. In the second section of this program, we'll have Professor Zaman Stanizai, who is going to join us, and he'll be answering questions or discussing the current American foreign policy in Afghanistan, in Asia, and other issues of importance in international politics. Stanizai has published extensively in Afghan politics and other international political issues, and it will be an honor to have him on this program. Let's begin then with the major things that happened, or one of the most important thing that happened last year, which was the re-election of President Barack Obama. For those supporters of Barack Obama, for President Barack Obama, those being elected for a second term is an exciting time. So it was exciting for them, and perhaps for many other people in the world. But it's also this new elections coming for a new term comes with a lot of challenges. What are those challenges? What are some of the problems that international politics today face the United States and the globe in general? This is something that we will try to deal with throughout this semester. Now, the 2012 or this year 2013 marks the fifth year since the world economic crisis started back in 2007, 2008, and we are still muddling through it. The good example of that is the austerity measures, the cuts, the debate that continues to exist between Democrats and Republicans, the philosophical issues that relate to whether we have too much government or less government, and what shall we cut. And that was highlighted just last week when finally Congress came to resolve the fiscal, what we call the fiscal cliff. So we are in our fifth year, and the economic crisis continues to loom and with new challenges. We will discuss this at the future time, and something that is very, very important. So we'll have a whole semester whole session for it. There are other challenges, the challenges that we face in the Middle East, for example. The Middle East, just 2 years ago, we thought that the Middle East was going in a different direction, that finally the Middle East is catching up with the rest of the world, building democratic systems, and finally power was sort of taken by the people. But we've seen more and more that's not as easy as it seems. People are talking about the setbacks. What is once was known or continues to be known as the Arab Spring is now referred to as more of a winter or as a downhole or something, a disaster or a collapse, or other adjectives that you may, or description you may add to describe the chaos or the counter-revolutionary things that are happening, the killing in Syria, the unsettling situation in Yemen, Egypt, and Tunisia. All of this raised new concerns about whether the Arab world and the Muslim and the Arab world in this case, or the Middle East in particular, is ripe for democratic change. And people question whether there is something inherent in this society that makes it less democratic or makes it undemocratic. What do you think? Do you think that the Arab Spring is heading in the right direction? Was it the right thing? Why do you think the chaos continue to prevail in this part of the world? More than that, how do you see the current situation in Syria? And we have a clip later on when my guests will be here, and we'll talk more about that situation there. So we have a lot of things in the Middle East that are changing. Related to that, I just mentioned Syria. Syria now we have about 60,000 people killed. There are about 800,000 refugees. These are registered refugees in neighboring countries, including Lebanon and Turkey. A major humanitarian disaster is unfolding, and the world is still watching. Should the United States intervene? Should the United Nations intervene? What shall we do about Syria? I will discuss that in a second. Related to that is the unfinished business revolutions. Some a better description of what's happening in the Middle East, and we'll deal with this later on in depth, is more of the outcome of a populist movement. What we have had is popular rising in Tunisia, in Libya, and in Egypt, along with what's happening in Syria, Bahrain, which disappeared from the scene, Yemen. So all of this are happening. These are popular movement. Perhaps the best way to describe them are popular movement rather than revolutionaries. Where are they hidden? If we look at Tunisia, for example, today the news is that Tunisia doesn't even have money to pay its public workers, or the public service is having major problems meeting the needs. Tunisia is a country that relies heavily on tourism, and that tourism, because of what's happening, what's happening in the region, has sort of not been helping. In other words, people, because the situation is unstable, people are not visiting Tunisia as they used to. Next door there is Libya. Libya, we thought we had a solution there for an alternative for the dictatorship that lasted for so many years, for over 4 decades. But now we're facing with additional problems. The conflict between Benghazi and Tripoli, the tribal conflicts. And what makes it even more difficult and more complex is the fact that the institutions placed, so-called democratic institutions, are built around tribalism. The parliament, the Libyan parliament, which was elected just months ago, had only 80% of the 300 members are. I'm sorry, of the 280 members. 80 members of those are only run under political parties' umbrellas. In other words, 200 members run as individuals, and a lot of times as representing tribes, their tribes, more than political institutions. Will Libya be able to develop into a nation state where tribalism is not a major hindrance to its collective national characteristics? Will the Libyan be able to think beyond their tribal bounds and think of themselves as a nation? So far, what we have seen is we are still not there, but there are the institutions that are placed in place could be revamped or modeled in ways that will promote more nationalism than tribalism. Certainly, the parliament, the structure of the parliament elected recently, does not favor nationalism. It supports tribalism more than anything else. Well, then you have the major problem in Egypt. And Egypt, it's a topic that we'll always talk about. Egypt is known to be, or is referred to in the Arab world as the heart of the Arab world. If that heart is healthy, then the entire region is healthy. For a moment there, we thought that actually the Egyptians got it, and that secularism, liberal policies, that tolerance, all of those were going to take over, and that Egypt was showing us how to have democratic institutions. But then there were elections, and however we describe them, they produced the Islamists as winner, the Muslim Brotherhood, or the president with leaning towards the Muslim Brotherhood, and about 25% of the Salafi groups. These are hardcore Islamists in the parliament, and we went through Egypt went through challenging times with riots and with the president taking more power to a point where people didn't see much difference between the old regime and the new regime, and we have to wait until we see where Egypt's going. But Egypt has major problem. One of them is this conflict between religious and secular, Both groups so far have been using violent means to impose their views. We had demonstrations, we had people in jail, all of that. It doesn't speak well for a revolution that was once a revolution of everybody, and now it seems to be turning into different parts. The president, Morsi, certainly has not helped, because he seems to be also leaning toward the Muslim Brotherhood, establishing certain kind of what people are describing as a theocratic religious state. Whether that is his goal, we have yet to see it, but certainly the structure, the elections, the latest development point in that direction, that the new upper house that is supposed to be elected in the next 2 months, the lower house, I'm sorry, next 2 months, is positioned to be, is expected to be won by the Islamists. And the lower house is expected, part of its constitutional prerogatives, is to legislate. And in that context, if the lower house is won by the majority of Muslim, the Islamist political parties, there are questions or there are concerns that the Egyptian state will be more theocratic than what was expected. So far, why is this important? Because the constitution that was just voted on about 2 weeks ago, or 3 weeks ago, left a lot of vague issues, among them the issue of the Sharia state, whether Egypt is expected to build or to establish a theocratic state. That was left vague. Some people say no, it is based on tolerance, and that the intention there was not to have theocratic states, but it remains to be vague. So a majority in the upper and the lower house, with the prerogative to legislate, are given strong concerns to those who feel that Egypt, who have concerned that theocracy is not the answer. So we'll see what's going to happen in the future in Egypt. Related to that is the issue of the relationship between the military and the civilian, particularly the military and the Muslim Brotherhood. Underlying issue under the struggle between the military and the Muslim Brotherhood, there is a long tradition of animosity. The current military was not, to say it the least, was not very friendly toward the Muslim Brotherhood. The Muslim Brotherhood were in jail and tortured by people who might be in the military today, or the police. So there is this long history of animosity between the two groups. But underneath that, there is another issue: is the economic interests. Economically, the military benefited tremendously under the President Hosni Mubarak. And the Islamists now may want a share of that. So there is a conflict also over economic interests. Who gets the big businesses? Who gets the big contract? Could be an issue underlying this struggle. So the challenge for Egypt, therefore, is to overcome this problem, this struggle between the military and the Islamists. And so we'll have to wait, and hopefully in the next 2 months, we'll see the elections in the lower house, and we may have an Egyptian scholar who will help us go through that. And then there is another important issue in the Middle East, which is the Middle East peace process. The Palestinians decided to, you know, we need to upgrade our status. Now we want to be a state. We want to be like the Vatican. We are fed up with the Israelis, who doesn't want to negotiate with us, who continue to violate our basic human rights, who continue to attack us. Now we're going to go to the United Nations and get our own states. And, you know, they threatened last year, and they succeeded this year. So now that the Palestinians have a state or recognized by the international community, what does that state mean? And more important, is this a step in the right direction, where we say now we could actually have two-state solutions, one for the Palestinians and one for the Israelis. So the question for you is the two-state solution long advocated since 1993, or probably some people go further, 1989, when the Palestinians recognized the existence of the Israeli state, or to 91. So it's a long a goal that has been there for so many years. Is that two-state solution viable? What do you think? Will the Israelis and Palestinians live next to each other? It's a challenge, and I would look forward to hearing your comments or question or a question in this regard. Now, those are the challenges. Now, outside the Middle East, there are a huge challenges. Africa is continuing to struggle. Economic development, water is lacking. Water issues are huge. Food is major problems. We have civil wars. After all, Mali, just the south of in the West Africa, half of the country is taken by Islamist radicals. Nigeria, one of the largest suppliers of oil, is having major problems, continues to have major problems in the world. Somalia, Ethiopia, Somalia is still divided into three countries. We don't know which are, and the terrorism continues to be rampant in the area. In the meantime, United States is on record for making Africa as one of its most strategic areas. Back in 2005, Dick Cheney declared that Africa's oil is strategic, and by that, just to give you an idea how significant that African oil. The only other strategic, oil that got that distinction was the Gulf oil of the Gulf. So with Africa having so much oil in certain countries, particularly Ghana, Nigeria, and other places, Africa has become one of the most important strategic region for the United States, to a point where for years now, the United States has been debating creating or moving their central command, the African Central Command. And President George W. Bush was one of those people who was pushing it. And in two of his trips, his goal was to find a home for a central command in Africa. None of the African countries accepted to host such a command. So now, all the business, the military business, are run or continue to run from Germany, Stuttgart. So the significance of Africa to the world must be looked at, and the United States is on top of things. The United States spends a lot of money on combating terrorism, or what it sees as terrorism, on businesses, on economic areas, military. There is a lot of money spent there for the United States, but it's being challenged by another country, China, which brings me to another challenge. How do we deal with China? China continues to be a major economic power. China has more trade relations, treaties in Africa than in any other country. And the Africans seem to be happy with the way the Chinese have treated them. The China has about a treaty with 44 states in Africa, considering that Africa's states are about 52 or 53, it depends. There are some countries that are not counted as state, but we're talking about 52 states. Of those 52 states, China has trade relations with 44 of them. That is a huge difference, a huge contribution to the African economy. More so, the Africans seem to like the idea of dealing with China on an economic basis, with not that colonial heritage that existed a long time ago. Of course, the Chinese are being criticized for giving bad products, for giving low-quality products, for not doing the business as good as the Americans or the Westerners. But despite those criticisms, Taoism, the Chinese seems to prevail in the African continent. They are just in Algeria. They are involved in so many projects, including building a freeway from linking the west to the east part of the country. 33,000 Chinese are in Algeria. Of those, many of them have sort of become part of the Algerian life, married Algerians, have businesses, all of that stuff. So the idea there is that you have this trend where China is becoming a force in international politics. Next to China, there is India as an emerging power. India is also very, very strong in areas of telecommunications. How does the United States deal with us, with China, with these emerging powers? Or in Latin America, where you have the Brazil becoming more and more of an important power in international politics. All of this to suggest that there are so many challenges in international politics. Those challenges, we hope we are going to discuss them in this class. So before I get to my first video, let me go back to the President Barack Obama's election this year, and give us a perspective. What are some of the challenges that the United States is facing or will face in the next 4 years? This video is about the Middle East, but it set us for a good start. With President Barack Obama coming to power, he has all these challenges in front of him. So we'll see how those challenges are going to impact. I will study them, looking at the implications, looking at them, how they affect American foreign policy and the world in general. I expect your comments. Please call the number or send us an email. So let's watch the first clip of this broadcast.
President Obama started the day with another election rally, trying to convince Americans he should have 4 more years. Yet, in just 2 months, Americans will head to the polls to vote for the presidency, and the latest polls have Republican candidate Mitt Romney and Barack Obama neck and neck. The latest attack in Libya that left 4 Americans dead, one of them being the ambassador to Libya, has now put the president's foreign policy practices, which have often been criticized, front and center in the presidential debate. Many GOP officials sought to fit the attacks in Libya to say Obama's leadership skills are lacking.
This is an attempted October surprise. You say it's only September. Well, it's an October surprise beginning in September. And it aims at influencing the U.S. presidential elections, I would say.
His opponent, Romney, came out and said the president should not be apologizing.
I think for Governor Romney, having seen that statement, to react as he did is the reaction that most Americans would have.
Meanwhile, Democratic strategists have rejected the assaults and are trying to defend the president's foreign policies.
Governor Romney's comments are about as inappropriate as anything I have ever seen at this kind of a moment. They are flat wrong. But they demonstrate an insensitivity and a lack of judgment about what is happening right now. To make those kinds of statements before you even know the facts, before families have even been notified, before things have played out, is really not just inexperienced, it's irresponsible, it's callous, it's reckless.
Regardless, political analysts say this is bad news for the president.
Ultimately, that's going to be harmful for Obama. In other words, it's going to his so-called foreign policy success is going to be undercut. There's a complication, though, which is that when you have these crises, what happens here in the U.S. is you get the rally round effect. In other words, if people think there's a real big crisis, they tend to support the president no matter who it is.
But Republicans say the American voters are sure to read this as a weakness and failure by the Obama administration. Meanwhile, several other analysts say Mitt Romney's comments will serve him damage, saying he lacks temperament and judgment. Ashante Hathaway, President.
Welcome back to Carcetti Dominguez Hills, Political Science 335, International Politics. And we are going over some of the major issues in 2012. That was a clip from BBC looking at the impact of the killing of US ambassador in Benghazi on the elections. And a point there that the reason we showed that clip was to bring you into focus, to tell us, and if you have a view, whether President Barack Obama has the skills to be a good foreign policy maker. In the past, we have had people who made international politics as part of their legacies. I can think of President Bill Clinton, who was very successful, and he left a legacy in international politics better than most. He used international politics, particularly the Middle East peace process, as one of his successes or one of his legacies. Others, they've done so much in that area too. So do you think that President Barack Obama has the skills and his legacy will be looked at from a foreign policy perspective more than domestic politics? How do you assess his last 4 years? Was he good foreign policy? What happened to those promises he made? What happened to what happened to his pledges to close Guantanamo and torture? All of those issues that were very, very important in his election 2008, has he met them? Those are the challenges that President Barack Obama faced during that time. So I'd like to hear your view. What do you think? Is President Barack Obama a good foreign policy maker? Remember also the question is the Palestinian state, is a two-state solution still viable? And I see we have a caller. So let me take the call. Esther, hi.
Yeah, hi, how are you? My name is Esther Halabi Rodriguez, and I'm calling you because I've been in the Middle East. My husband is Lebanese. Uh-huh. I am Mexican American. Uh-huh. And I see the injustice they've been for the Palestinians. Mm-hmm. Okay, and I see, I don't agree with what they're doing to the Palestinians, and I'm really upset that they give them 5 minutes to the Palestinians to stay in their home, and they go and put a bomb, and they have to go out to build houses for people that come from Russia, for the Jewish, or they come from Europe, and I don't agree with that. And I teach a lot of Hispanic people the real truth, because they don't know the truth, and they're always blaming the Palestinians, and this is not true. It's a political thing, even in some churches, mm-hmm. you know, and then I don't agree. When I hear the pastor preaching about, you know, I get upset, and I talk to him, and I told her they are humans, they are like us. I mean, you don't supposed to be that way with the Palestinians, you know. And they've been mistreated. They go to Lebanon. They don't give them passport. They go to Syria. They don't have passport to cross the border, and they suffer a lot, you know. And I don't understand why. I mean, this government. I'm not talking about the people of Israel. Mm-hmm. I'm talking about the government in Israel. Why he want to just push the Palestinians? If you guys don't be careful, they will take Lebanon. I mean, God forgive me, I say that they will, because the book say that they will take Lebanon, they will take Syria, they will take Jordan. Where they want to put the Arabs? My kids are, I have Arabs. My husband is Lebanese. So, you know, I don't agree with all the politics they have, especially this Netanyahu. Mm-hmm. And then another thing, they have groups here. You know what they do? Because I do work with Jewish people, between me and you. I mean, they have meetings, and they go like a private meetings, and they come and they tell the Jewish, American Jewish people, they tell them, they watch the brains, and they tell them about the Arabs, about the Palestinians, even about the Latinos. Mm-hmm. You know, they, you know, and I got shocked when one of my clients took me to the meeting, and I say, oh my God, she didn't know that my husband was from the Middle East, and I heard everything, and I was shocked, and I said, when do you guys have these meetings? There is a guy, and you can see the guy, he's scared, he's looking everywhere to the right and the left, and you see he come and give the meeting, I think from New York, and then he tell all the American Jewish this and that about the Palestinians, about the Arabs and everything. I mean, what's going on? Why we don't have peace? Why we don't give the land and the right to the Palestinians? You know, they kill children, they kill kids, and then other things. I watch another program.
Let me ask you a straightforward question. Do you think that the United States is on the right track? That the United States has a good foreign policy towards the Palestinians? How do you look at the foreign policy?
Okay, the foreign policy, I don't think it's too good, because the United States, they're not forcing Israel to give legally the piece of land for the Palestinians. I don't think United States does what the Jews told him to do. Not Obama. They hate Obama now. They're talking about the other presidents.
Well, Esther, thank you so much. Please keep watching. I appreciate your comment, and thank you again. Esther's question raises a very, very important question. It's a point of view that we'll see a lot in the Middle East. The Middle East criticized the American foreign policy makers for having one-sided foreign policy, meaning being too friendly with the Israelis at the expense of the Palestinians, and that approach. From the Middle Eastern perspective, has not been has created more problems, had made the United States look worse than where it was. And a point that you'll find among different groups. And the issue today for the Palestinians and the Israelis is how to overcome those challenges. In 1993, with the Oslo Agreement, there was an attempt to bring the two sides together, bringing the Israelis, the Palestinians, and work for a common solution. And the solution was, you know, you have your stereotypes, you have your beliefs, wrong or right or wrong, and I do have mine. This is, but we cannot continue to fight this. So what the Oslo Agreement in 1993 set, it set a stage for building mutual confidence measures. That for the first time, the Israelis and the Palestinians were having a conversation, and they were engaged in constructive dialogue. Now, the agreement of Oslo had many, many, many problems, to a point where, and the biggest challenge or glaring problem, is how the Palestinians understood it, and how the Israelis understood it. There were two different interpretations. The Palestinians thought that the Oslo gave them independence, that they were going to live as free, like the Israelis, that they would have their state, and their state will be, or would be, in the West Bank and Gaza, that they are going to, they have finally got it, that they have the states. Their price, that they recognize the Israelis, that they will be satisfied with these two places, Gaza and West Bank, give up all the other rights that they had before. And for that, they truly believed and celebrated in the street. Now, the Israelis, it was a different interpretation. The Israelis said, no, we agreed to discuss your independence. We agreed to sit down, have a constructive dialogue, and we start negotiating on whether you should have a state or not. So, and if you have to have a state, it's going to be with a small s. There are certain things that we are not going to allow you, just like you are, you have certain principles that you don't want to give up. The Palestinians wanted to make sure that they have Jerusalem, half of Jerusalem, that they agreed that Jerusalem should be shared between the Israelis and the Palestinians. We didn't really care that much about other religion, despite the fact that Jerusalem is a world city. There is a United Nations resolution that makes it a world city. So we really didn't, the Palestinian Israelis did not care about that. The Palestinians so agreed that they are going to have to share Jerusalem. They agreed that, they will discuss it. And they agreed they will discuss about the refugees and the borders. The Israelis also were on map. I mean, they were on that. So the discussion for them, for the different interpretation of the different interpretations did not help much. And we actually lived a good dialogue, an era between 93 to 1996. This is before what Esther was talking about, Benjamin Netanyahu coming to power. At that time, there was actually there was improvement in the dialogue. Yitzhak Rabin and Yasser Arafat had a good rapport. They worked together and they were moving forward. A reason they had that success is The Yitzhak Rabin generation is the older generation, the generation that actually believed that Israelis and Palestinians could coexist, that the Israelis wanted, believed that the security of Israel is to have a rapprochement or a normalization of relations with the Arabs, that for Israel to exist as a free and independent state, it has to get the recognition of its neighboring Arab states. So there was the Israeli leadership, including Yitzhak Rabin, Shamir, Shimon Peres, all of these leaders believed in coexistence of the Israelis and the Palestinians because they strongly believed that the only way for Israel to continue to exist, or Israel was much better if it gets recognized by its neighbor. The recognition of Arab neighbors is the security, will secure Israel's existence in the region. Well, 96, when Netanyahu came in, it became a really different, the new generation. These are the generation that fled the Soviet Union. And Netanyahu, being a conservative who did not believe in the peace process, did not help either. And from then we shifted from this dialogue where let's know each other, build better relationship, to really more of a talking at each other more than anything else. Netanyahu continued to talk about the terrorism, and the Palestinians continued to talk about, you know, lack of progress. Both parties were saying they don't have any partners. Israel is more so in this case than the Palestinians. And we, you know, from 96, we are here with nothing happening, problems after problems. And in the meantime, Esther is correct. There is a serious, serious violation of Palestinian rights. And there is a humanitarian issue that needs to be addressed in the region, but we forgot it. And the Arab Spring sort of also distracts us from that Middle East peace process. Going back to the negotiation process, to the negotiation table, should be the ultimate goal. And we'll see whether this will be one of Obama's legacies. So what do you think? Is a Palestinian state still viable? How about those who argue that, you know, how about the Israeli rights? Is that still something that we want to address, that you think should be taken into account, that terrorism is something that need to be addressed first before any peace process we're going to start. It's a serious problems, and the Obama administration so far has failed us in more than ways than one. But Obama got something new also. We may have a new Secretary of State. The new Secretary of State replacing Hillary Clinton is now is John Kerry. He's just nominated. He has to get the approval of the Senate. My next clip, it's a very short clip, will highlight this nomination. So let's watch this clip, and when we come back, I'd like to know more about your opinion. Give us a call on whether the two-state solution is still a good idea, or whether President Obama is a good foreign policy maker and he has the skills to succeed in international politics. Those two issues that you may address. Let's watch this clip.
Be really careful and thoughtful. For John Kerry, the leap from five-term senator to President Barack Obama's choice to be Secretary of State doesn't appear to be a big one. The president has regularly tapped the Massachusetts senator for assignments in places like Afghanistan and Pakistan. The chairman of the Senate Foreign Relations Committee has taken on the unusual role of envoy to the world's trouble spots.
I think for the most part, Kerry and Obama are pretty well aligned. They're both pragmatic.
Analyst Michael O'Hanlon says Kerry is seasoned, and the transition from Secretary of State Hillary Clinton shouldn't be dramatic.
There's actually a fair amount of continuity with Clinton. They're both rock solid. They've both known the field very well. Kerry, of course, has been working in the field even longer than Hillary Clinton.
In a way, Kerry's nomination closes a circle with him and the president. In 2004, it was Kerry, the Democratic presidential nominee, who gave Obama, then a candidate for Senate, a life-changing spot at the party's convention. And when it came time to support Obama's presidential bids, Kerry was full-throated.
Ask Osama bin Laden if he is better off now than he was 4 years ago.
Ultimately, Kerry could provide a steady hand in an uncertain world.
You have to handle a lot of crises that come up when they come up. And a lot of them tend to be in the broader Middle East, where Kerry is very strong. And some of them tend to be in places like Pakistan and North Korea.
Kerry's fortunes rose after UN Ambassador Susan Rice withdrew her name from consideration for Secretary of State. He's been praised by some of the same Republican senators who voiced uncertainty about Rice. His confirmation by the Senate is nearly certain. Matt Friedman, Associated Press.
Welcome back to International Politics. This is Calce Dominguez Hills. Television program, and we are on that was our second clip, the nomination of John Kerry. The consensus among many people that he is a pragmatist, he has the experience, he will do well in being in charge of foreign policy, American foreign policy. What do you think? Is that a good choice? Was he a better choice than Susan Rice? Was Susan Rice mistreated because of her mishandling of the Benghazi problem or situation? Can Kerry overcome the challenges with the crises that face the world in many different countries, including the Middle East and Europe? Those are questions that we still have to wait. Number one, it has to be confirmed by the Senate committee, and then the second thing is to see him at work. But another agreement that we've seen from the report is that there seemed to be a smooth transition between the role between Hillary Clinton and John Kerry. Both are pragmatists. Both have knowledge in international politics, more so with Kerry than Hillary Clinton. And they both seem to be very well respected individuals or leaders in Washington and elsewhere. The question for you: will Kerry be a good Secretary of State, or would he, or Obama should have stuck with Susan Rice? That's the online email address that you could send us if you have a question. askdhtv@gmail.com, or you could call us on the 800 number. Okay, so we're still waiting for your phone calls. And certainly Kerry has a lot of things to do. And one area that he has to deal with is the Syrian conflict. Now, Syria is going from one is going through major problems. Syria is so far the numbers are alarming. About 60,000 refugees, 60,000 people killed. Over 800,000 people, refugees. These are registered refugees. We're not talking about the informal. Those are unofficial statistics. Those people who leave don't go through the United Nations refugees process. Syria is going through major problems. But let's watch this clip, and then when we come back, we'll look at where are we going with this Syria? Where is Syria going? Should the United States intervene in Syria? And should the United States intervene in Syria? So let's watch it for a few minutes.
The Syrian military has purportedly launched fresh airstrikes in eastern Ghouta near Damascus, according to this unverified video uploaded by activists. Signs continue to build that President Bashar al-Assad's regime could be close to falling, while Iran has denied rumors emanating from the West. Another key ally, Russia, has sent warships to the Mediterranean to prepare for a potential evacuation of its citizens. Just 3 kilometers from the center of Damascus, Assad's heartland, clashes continue at the Yarmouk refugee camp, which was stormed by Syrian rebels. The densely populated districts of the city have become home to thousands of Palestinians over the years. When the uprising began 21 months ago, the estimated 500,000 Palestinians living in Syria mostly stayed on the sidelines. But observers say as the conflict escalates, most are now backing the rebels. At the border with Turkey, a journalist for American network NBC has spoken for the first time about his kidnap ordeal. Richard Engel described how he and his crew were seized on Thursday. They were kept bound and blindfolded and were repeatedly threatened.
Welcome back to Casa Dominguez Hills, DHTV. We are going to take a break for 5 minutes. In the meantime, think about the question that I ask you. Should the United States intervene or the United Nations intervene in Syria? I will ask my guest, Dr. Zaman Istinazai, the same question, but I'd like also to hear your views. So we'll be back in 5 minutes. Keep watching.
You are watching DHTV, the television program service of California State University, Dominguez Hills.
November 1st through November 28th, El Caballo, the horse in Mexican folk art, Day of the Dead altars, and the student showcase in studio art. Mexico celebrates a rich tradition of arte popular that reaches more than 2,000 years into the Mesoamerican past. El Caballo, the horse in Mexican folk art, celebrates this enduring tradition through a variety of ceramics, metalwork, paper art, sculpture, and other works of art. A special Day of the Dead altar installation by Dr. Miguel Dominguez, professor of modern languages, will also be on display, as well as a Day of the Dead altar by the prominent Los Angeles artist Edith Abeita and CSUDH alumna artist Victoria Almeida.
Music. California State University Dominguez Hills Orthotic and Prosthetic Program is unique among the 11 accredited programs in the United States. Cal State program emphasizes heavily clinical input. All the schools are kind of shifting towards a theory-based practice, where the school here is showing that theory-based and showing the clinical applications, but we do it in a manner on patient models. We have 15 projects in prosthetics and 16 projects in orthotics with actual live patient models, which is either double or triple some of the other schools out there. So we do a lot more hands-on, a lot more fabrication end of it. So not only learning why we're making the devices, but we also learn how we're making the devices. So keep that technical input into the program. So that really makes our program unique amongst the other schools. For students looking to get into this field and find out a little bit more about prosthetics and orthotics, there's a few different resources for them. The National Commission of Orthotic and Prosthetic Education, ncope.org, has a great website to get some more information on. And we do have a specific website for careers in orthotics and prosthetics that goes through how you become a practitioner, how you can implement your skills, and then learn about the various schools and what they offer. And that's opcareers.org, so opcareers.org. It's a great website to get more information on that. Our site, calstatedominguezhills.edu.
Hi, my name is Mark Darcy. I'm a student at CSUDH, and I'm in the Orthotics and Prosthetics program. I love this program, I enjoy it, and this is my dream.
Tune in to DHTV on Tuesday nights at 9 p.m. for Jazz in the Modern Era with Chet Hanley, the only live interactive jazz program on cable television in Southern California. If you like jazz, you'll love Jazz in the Modern Era.
Watching DHTV, the broadcast program service of California State University Dominguez Hills.
Welcome back to California State University Dominguez Hills. This is DHTV, and we are discussing issues of international politics. We did a general overview of some of the challenges that face the American President Barack Obama. And in this new segment, we are fortunate to have in the studio Dr. Zaman Stenezai. Welcome, Zaman. I'm glad you're here.
Thank you.
Let me ask a question that you want me to ask. The two-state solution, is that a viable solution? You see it at this point between the Israelis and the Palestinians, that the two-state solution, long advocated in Oslo, and is it still is it a possibility? Is it a viable solution at this point?
Well, the way I look at it, I think the problem mainly is that Israel is a state that's modeled after a European state, a segregated state, an exclusionary state, a state in the name of an ethnic group or in the name of a religious group. Middle Eastern states do not have this this European characteristic. Muslim states, or the ones that are Muslim majority, they are states that are not exclusive to any particular group. So therefore, you could have ethnic minorities or majorities, but the exclusion part is what causes a problem. I think that if
let me interject there. But you have certain kind of exclusion. For example, the Saudis, mm-hmm. if you are part of the royal family, you are in the state. But how is that different from saying all the Jews have their own states?
No, the Saudis might have a privileged class.
Privileged, okay.
That's different than having an exclusionary, like a Jewish state, which is just supposedly, at least by definition, just for the Jews. And on the same principle, I'm against any state. That's my personal philosophy. Any state that's exclusive for any particular ethnic, religious, or other group in that way. Because the human societies in general are not necessarily segregated. They are because in the European model, when you go on the base of European nationalism is nothing but racism that is politically endorsed and becomes the official policy. Now, if they wanted to have a state like that, the European model state in Europe, that would have been fine. Because, say, at least in principle, all the French would have been French and all the English would have been English, and there would have been a state for all the Jews. That would have been a European model in Europe. If they wanted to have a European, a non-European model, a Middle Eastern model state in the Middle East, then it had to have been inclusive for all parties concerned. So and that's where the problem is, that it's not so much that one is a Jewish state, the other one is an Arab state or a Palestinian state. Those are politically defined states out of the necessity of creating a European model state in a non-European environment.
So that aside, then, how does that link to the two-state solution? Okay, if we had
the Middle Eastern model, it wouldn't have mattered whether the population was majority Jewish or majority Muslim or majority Christian.
That everybody will be
exactly passed. Because the state would have been defined, and this state would have had many ethnic components to it, just like every other state. And there is no state in the Middle East or in the Muslim world in general. Take Iraq, for example. We are trying to apply the European model now to Iraq, create a Shia Iraq, create a Sunni Iraq, and create a Kurdish Iraq, which is simply at one level is divide and conquer. But another level, it's segregating society at the very basis of it, which is very, very destructive. And I think if we have one state in the Middle East, say Palestine, Israel, whatever the name might be, in which there is no privileged class like the Saudis, the Saudi royal family in Saudi Arabia, or the Jews in the state of Israel, they are privileged compared to their non-Jewish citizens. So if you had a state like that, the whole question of one state and two state would be irrelevant because you would have one state, all citizens will be equally responsible and equal participants in the political process, regardless of what religion they want. But the problem now is that they want an exclusive state, and this is mostly bad for the Jewish concept, because historically Jews have suffered for centuries because of this exclusion policy, primarily in Europe. They were excluded. And now for a Jewish state to come and adopt the very same policy, which hinder their progress, which discriminated against them, and use that policy against another people, that's where the problem is.
Okay, let me move a little bit. We'll come back to this subject another time, and, and I'm sure we'll just head in depth. We just saw a clip about what's happening in Syria. What do you think is this a situation where the Security Council, the United States, is expected to go in and do the same thing they did in Libya?
If you read my article on Libya, I think you would understand what my position is.
I should have read it.
Which is on my website for the readers to consult.
That's a good plug,
Here's the problem. The Arab Spring, it's a wonderful idea, long overdue. However, when the spring comes, instead of allowing the trees and the grass and the plants and the vegetations to grow naturally in its own environment, to bring about the changes that are the people's demands, which will make it legitimate, we interfere. We want to, the United States, for instance, want to have, okay, if Assad's regime is gone, they want to make sure that the next regime that comes is friendly to the United States.
Those are the conditions.
And even if that friendliness would be illegitimate in the sense that if such a regime would prioritize American interests vis-a-vis the interests of its own people, which has been the case in most Middle Eastern states, mm-hmm. where American allies prioritize American interests over the interest of their own people, and in that sense make them those states become illegitimate. So if we allow any state, and in this case Syria, mm-hmm. to bloom and blossom in its own right way, mm-hmm. create its own government mm-hmm. that will be representative of its own people, which is what a democracy ought to be, then that would be fine. But the thing is that we have so many chefs mm-hmm. who jump into this kitchen and they want to make sure that the, I wouldn't mention the animal, whatever food is being mm-hmm. cooked mm-hmm. is cooked based on their taste. That's the external factors. Mm-hmm. And so that's why, in a way, we are hindering mm-hmm. the process of the Arab Spring. And we are preventing the creation of legitimate governments. Mm-hmm. And we are more interested in creating proxies for our foreign policy interests instead of allowing people to have their own mm-hmm. governments, which, mm-hmm. if we use the American motto, should be a government of the people, for the people, and by the people.
Let me remind our viewers to call us with a question or a comment or to email us. My guest is Dr. Zaman Stanadzai. But are you telling us that actually what happened in Syria, what's happened in Egypt, what happened in Libya and in Tunisia, that all those leaders that came prioritized American interests at the expense of their national interests?
I don't think there's anything wrong for a government, say, in Egypt, mm-hmm. that accommodates its foreign policy vis-a-vis the United States. Mm-hmm. After all, foreign diplomacy is the mm-hmm. name of the game. All governments do that, and that's legitimate. Mm-hmm. The point is that when a revolution in progress is hijacked mm-hmm. to affect the consequence of it, mm-hmm. primarily on the basis of the interest of a foreign power, then that government is not legitimate. Egypt, what we had was the United States made several attempts, mm-hmm. Step by step, mm-hmm. And every time they tried to prevent one stage, it moved on to the next one, to the next one. In each case, we wanted to, in a sense, to have a government in Egypt mm-hmm. that would be friendly to the United States and friendly to Israel, as if a government that would be legitimate in terms of its own people should of necessity be opposed to the state of Israel or opposed to, which I don't think is the case.
How do you assess the current or the U.S. relationship towards the current Egyptian president, Morsi? Do you see it as a friendly relationship, or is it more of an, is it at that alliance level?
It's an alliance of necessity, mm-hmm. because in the West in general and in the United States in particular, any political party that has the word Islam or Islamic attached mm-hmm. to it mm-hmm. Is automatically blacklisted. Mm-hmm. And of course, they would react towards that one way or another. In the case of the Muslim Brotherhood, for instance, first, every effort was made to blame the revolution on them in a way that they are responsible for the chaos and mayhem. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. And the Muslim Brotherhood did the smartest thing by staying on the sideline pretty much mm-hmm. in the earlier stages of the mm-hmm. revolution. And people were saying, like, how come they are collaborating with the militarists? Mm-hmm. The point is that they didn't want to take the blame because they felt that they were targeted. So mm-hmm. that was a good thing on the part of the Muslim Brotherhood. Mm-hmm. Later, when they came to power, slowly, the United States position was to accept them hesitantly, but mm-hmm. remember, when the parliamentary elections were conducted, they won the majority. Mm-hmm. We should have accepted that. Well, mm-hmm. we re-accepted it with reservation. Yeah. Then came the presidential election, but the presidential election results were held for, I think, at least 5 days. They were not announced, and then here was the tricky part of it, is that they were not ready to accept a Muslim Brotherhood president with mm-hmm. a Muslim Brotherhood parliament in Egypt, mm-hmm. which would have meant that they would really have been more independent mm-hmm. and they would not have relied on the United States so much. Mm-hmm. What they did was that they said, I mm-hmm. wasn't in the inner circles, but one assumes that perhaps a conversation similar to this took place, that, well, okay, let them have the presidency, but take the parliament back, mm-hmm. which is what happened. Is that the parliament, which was the most legitimate, based on foreign observers looking at the whole process, that legitimate parliament, a representative of the people of Egypt, was denied to the people of Egypt. Why? Because they also elected a Muslim Brotherhood president. Mm-hmm. And that is just like, to speak through analogy, is that mm-hmm. if we say, if the U.S. presidency is won by a Democratic Barack Obama, mm-hmm. then let's take the Senate back from the Democrats, because we can't let them have both, mm-hmm. which is what we really did.
We have a question. Just coming on the internet, isn't that what ultimately happened in the United States elections? The right-wing plan did not work, with the exception.
The difference is that Egypt is not the United States. The United mm-hmm. States may mess up its own election, whether it's the Supreme Court decree declaring one candidate a president as opposed to the other. It's our own internal mess. Mm-hmm. What happened in Egypt was that from the Egyptian perspective, everything went according to plan. There was no problem. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. The problem was sort of imposed from outside. Mm-hmm. And so perhaps not until they got commitments from the Egyptian president that, okay, we will let you become the president, but you have to be nice to Israel, mm-hmm. to which is a presumption like, why would it not be in the interest of Egypt itself mm-hmm. to have a friendly relationship with Israel? Because I think they are in the region, they are neighbors. The necessity demands that they be friendly without this policy being dictated to them from outside.
Before we move to another topic, just remind our viewers to call us with any questions. You raise a very, very important question, the viability of the two-state solution. And the alternative is to have a state that everybody will feel they are represented. Mm-hmm. But I'd like to take you to Afghanistan. There is mm-hmm. a clip, just to remind our the studio, is the clip number 7. This clip talks about or shows progress, how the reintegration of those who were taken to jail, how they become they are reintegrated in the Afghan society, or some of the problems that the Afghan population is facing. I know you wrote about a third alternative in Afghanistan. I read that article, so mm-hmm. I may not have read the Arab Spring, but I read the
Well, it's possible I may have forgotten what I've written myself. Then.
Well, let's watch the clip. We'll watch clip number 7. And when we come back, we'll talk about Afghanistan and other issues okay. in that region.
Abdul Satter should have plenty of time to finish the elaborate work he's doing. He's in jail for 16 years for drug dealing. There are murderers and kidnappers in the embroidery class too. Punishment fits the crime in the outdoor workshop where the bikes being rebuilt were worn out by a team destroying fields of opium poppies. The foreman is an ex-Taliban fighter, Abdul Ghani.
When I was in the Taliban, there was a lot of fighting, but it was all for nothing.
It is visiting day, and families are carefully searched as they enter the jail. Prisoners can share a few minutes of human warmth through the cold bars of their cell. Until only 4 years ago, this was a wild and dangerous place where prisoners often attacked the staff. That's changed, and the reforms are changing the lives of those who end up in what's still a place of punishment.
Through the processes that we put in, it is about tackling and de-radicalising these prisoners so that when we release them, hopefully they'll divert them away from the criminal insurgent-related activity.
Afghanistan has a reputation for brutality in treating its prisoners, so this is a really surprising place. And it has a counter-Taliban strategy too, in encouraging ex-prisoners not to go back to the insurgency. A small group of women prisoners live with their children, secluded from the male side of the jail. About half of the women in prison in Afghanistan are there for what's called running away, arrested after fleeing from violent or abusive husbands. One says she was married as a child to a violent man who mistreated her. Another was forced to go through a wedding even after her future husband had shot her brother. She ran away when he was violent to her. Life for many women in many parts of Afghanistan remains precarious, with some safer behind prison walls. David Loin, BBC News.
Welcome back to Khalsa Dominguez Hills. That was a clip from BBC. What do you think, Dr. Sanadzai? What's your reaction? This idea of rehabilitating prisoners and making them good sort of citizen in a sense. What's happening inside Afghanistan in terms of this policy or this idea of rehabilitating?
I think the problem started back in the Soviet state. Uh-huh. Which was where when they had a policy of quote-unquote Afghanization. Mm-hmm. And the idea was that to internalize the war in Afghanistan to create a civil war that wasn't there in the first mm-hmm. place, so mm-hmm. that when the Soviets leave Afghanistan, they will not be followed to Central uh-huh. Asia. Uh-huh. And the result of that was that the ethnic element was introduced. Uh-huh. After the first 10 years when nobody talked about ethnicity, everybody talked about the national jihad, the national resistance against the Soviet occupation. With the Soviet departure, the element of national resistance mm-hmm. was changed to defense of the rights of the ethnic minorities. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Which was a hoax in the real sense, in that in Afghanistan, yes, there were ethnic minorities, but the government was fully participatory for centuries, mm-hmm. and all classes, all ethnic groups participated proportionately, perhaps some not so proportionately. This is prior to the Soviet departure.
Okay. Now, in 1989.
Yeah. Now, with the U.S. invasion, they took the same blueprint mm-hmm. and used the same policy mm-hmm. of supporting the minorities mm-hmm. against the ethnic majority mm-hmm. in a way to give it a kind of the appearance of a legitimate struggle. Mm-hmm. The truth of the matter is that the Taliban, which was a group that was ethnically speaking, they were majority Pashtuns, mm-hmm. but it was the only political group mm-hmm. that was not exclusively ethnic. The minority groups were exclusively ethnic. If it was a Hazara party, it was only for Hazaras. If it was an Uzbek, only for Uzbeks. The Taliban party was the only one that was not exclusively Pashtuns. It was predominantly Pashtun, yes, but it was not exclusively.
Was that because it had more of a religious tendencies, that the religions appeared to all groups, or is it just came as a natural process?
No, that is, I think, a natural trend in most societies, that the ethnic majority in every group has mm-hmm. to act in a sense to accept the exclusion.
Okay.
I mean, like in the United States, we have ethnic whites uh-huh. who have participated in supporting Jewish rights, they have participated in supporting civil rights for the African Americans, they are participating in, they are helping the Hispanics, the blacks, all the other groups. Mm-hmm. And these are primarily white ethnic Americans, and they cannot afford, a majority in any society cannot afford mm-hmm. to behave exclusively for their own interest, because that would appear racist. Mm-hmm. Now, the Taliban, out of that necessity, since the Pashtun are the majority, mm-hmm. I don't know if this was of any religious conviction. It may have been, but my observation is in any society, the majority acts like a majority.
There was some practical thing. I mean, it was, after all, the Taliban that was viewed as the harboring terrorism, anti-US, the Northern Alliance represented the minority. Mm-hmm. It became sort of the ultimate friend.
There was not a single political party in Afghanistan that did not have foreign patronage, whether it was the United States, whether it was Central Asia, Iran, Pakistan, Saudi Arabia, all of them had, in a way, a dog in this fight.
Yeah.
So that was there. But the problem, to get back to where the situation is now, Afghanistan now is a society that has been in a perpetual war for 35 years. So the problems that we observed here, what is happening to the woman, what is happening...
1980, the Soviet invasion.
Right, from 1979 on. So it was the first communist government, and then the Soviet invasion, and then the hiatus between the two invasions, and then the American invasion. So this war has been going on for a long time, and it has been targeting one or another group.
Mm-hmm.
In a way to, like I said, to internalize, to Afghanize the conflict.
Mm-hmm.
So what we have done as Americans, I'm speaking in terms of the American foreign policy,
mm-hmm.
is that we went to Afghanistan claiming that we are fighting Al-Qaeda.
Mm-hmm.
Once we realized there is not so much of an Al-Qaeda there, we transferred the blame to the Taliban. Yeah. And once the Taliban government fell, we transferred that blame to the entire Pashtun population.
Mm-hmm.
So instead of, because somehow in a warrior culture that American culture is, we cannot live without an enemy.
Mm-hmm.
So instead of saying, okay, there was an enemy, it was eliminated, now we can go to a normalcy.
Mm-hmm.
For us, the normalcy was simply transferring the blame, finding a new target, blaming it on a new group, and dealing with them that way. There would be no need for reintegration of most of these people that the clip showed if we had not disenfranchised them in the first place.
Mm-hmm.
So we disenfranchised them, targeted them, because we needed the support of the minorities from the north to fight their own brothers, the majority in the south.
Mm-hmm.
And now we are saying, okay, we need to reintegrate them back into the society.
Mm-hmm.
But the point is, why do the wrong thing in the first place? But that's the nature of things as is.
We have a couple questions coming. This is from, I think I got it. I think this is about the Pakistani girl shot in the head by the Taliban for promoting girls' education, has been released from the Penkerman Hospital to live with her family, doctors said Friday. I guess the question is, what's your reaction to that?
It's a very shameful thing for this to have happened, and her picture is on the front page of my Pashto website. A beautiful woman, young girl who went through her own struggle to ask for nothing but that which is the legitimate right of every human being, and in the context of an Islamic society, is that which is the command of the Quran, which says knowledge is incumbent upon every Muslim man and woman.
Mm-hmm.
So she was doing, to speak their language, she was doing her Islamic duty of educating herself. Now, what has happened in the Pakistani society, especially among the Pashtun ethnic minority in Pakistan, is that they have become the scapegoat for the Pakistani policy, state policy, as well as for the United States.
Yeah.
So that targeting I was talking about, Afghanistan, targeting the Pashtuns, has extended to targeting Pashtuns in Pakistan too. And that's why when the conflict was defined as an Afghanistan-Pakistan, the idea was that the target group had to be the Pashtuns because they are on the border between the two countries.
Let's see. Mike also has a few questions. Is the one who brought the question. So if the Taliban can't afford to act only in their own interest, what value was there in shooting the girl for simply wanting to go to school? seems like their policy imploded on the due to world to get world attention. Can we expect to see more implosions?
I think when a conflict such as that in Afghanistan happens, it is often convenient to vilify one particular group and blame everything on that group.
Yeah.
So in Afghanistan, there it's Transparency International just I think published its report last week, where Afghanistan is third from the bottom in terms of corruption.
Yeah. Yeah.
Now, in this corrupt system, whatever happens by whomever is automatically blamed on the Taliban. The police is corrupt. The military is corrupt and exclusive in a certain way. When you go to any government office, to most government offices, and by the way, I have an article on this one too, Afghanistan, where
they have your website.
Right. The readers could check that. Afghanistan, where chaos is king and plunder is privilege. That really shows the degree of corruption. But of course, it's very convenient to blame everything on the Taliban because they don't have a spokesperson. Now, I don't think the shooting of the girl in Peshawar is any worse than the shooting of another girl in Kapisa province in Afghanistan. Now, pretty much the same thing happened in Kapisa. A girl about the same age was shot and killed, but this was in a non-Pashtun area and we did not hear a thing about it.
Where
crime
was she
is
shot?
Crime. Well, she was shot, I think, either because she had she was either participating in some kind of a campaign, either for literacy or it was for vaccination or some such thing, which would have meant that it was bringing modernity, at least to her own village.
Yeah.
The situations are identical,
but
except that the culprit in one case was Pashtun, which is the targeted group. So that one got, you know, global attention. Whereas in the other case, it was a non-Pashtun village. We did not hear. A similar case happened a few months before, where a woman was shot in broad daylight, and it was the incident was recorded on a cell phone and then sent around the world. And again, this heinous crime happened in broad daylight, but it happened in a non-Pashtun area. And it was initially automatically blamed on the Taliban. But there were no Taliban, because when you watch the video, I mean, you hear the people speaking. These are just basically ignorant villagers who took the law into their own hand and whatever stupidity they believed in. And they shot the girl right in the village square. So I think there's not that one crime is any worse than the other.
But,
in essence, it's a bad thing as it is. But we publicize the ones where we can get some political what do we call
capital
it?
Or
a
something.
Capital out of the manipulation of the event.
I know you write a lot about an ethnically balanced Afghanistan where you have true representation. I think your answer about the having a state where all people are represented, feel represented. You wrote in an article, NATO's third alternative in Afghanistan, your critique, what you just said, is that the system that's been placed in Afghanistan so far has been ethnically based. And what you want, the alternative, is to have an ethnically balanced alternative. This comes on, you know, the talk that the United States will be withdrawing, NATO will withdraw. Is it still 2014, or is it earlier, sooner than expected? And is it 2003?
I think. Not that I believe it, but yeah, that's what they say.
I'll get to that point, actually. I'll ask you about that, too. But at this point, can you elaborate on the idea of establishing an ethnically balanced system in Afghanistan, particularly when it comes to the military and the military side of it?
Well, the military side is the worst part of it, because the new quote-unquote National Afghan Army is primarily an ethnic army of the ethnic minorities of the north, in which the most critical part is that the officer corps is 70% from one small valley. 70% of the officer corps in the Afghan National Army, it doesn't even come from an ethnic minority. It comes from a minority within a minority within a minority, from one narrow valley, the Panjshir Valley.
Why is that? I mean, why?
Because they were because the Minister of Defense
is from that region.
Was from there, and because they were at the forefront of the U.S. invasion force from the north, because they had also the support of Iran before the United States got involved
Northern
in it.
Alliance, yeah, yeah.
So that the ethnic card was played. And because of that, the structure of the military is off balance. The second thing is that the Pashtun majority is underrepresented. And so on top of this, then we have also the ghost soldier factor, which is in many of these minority areas, the commanders, regional commanders, simply present a list to the government of how many soldiers they have, and they collect the salary. And just like the insurance fraud in the United States, I mean the Social Security fraud in the United States, there are a lot of times that that money is collected by the officers, the senior officers, and the people on the paper are just names because it gives them a quota. And this quota is further promulgated by establishing new provinces for regions in the country that do not even have sufficient minimum population for that region, that valley, that area to become a province, because then there comes the provincial quotas. So in that sense, the corruption that is prevalent is a systemic corruption.
Okay.
And oppose this to let's say the Pashtun majority, who are not only is the region in the south in a state of war, but also there is an idea of underrepresentation. And this underrepresentation is partly the result of the elections that were held at the time of war, where the Taliban, who were trying to boycott the election, were threatening Pashtun candidates from running. So then the minority representatives ended up representing the majorities in the provinces because they were the only ones who could run.
Yeah.
So it's lopsided in that way too. So I think in order for the United States to leave Afghanistan, if it ever does, and that's where I was expressing my doubt earlier, then what is necessary is that to make sure they do not repeat the mistakes of the Soviets.
Speaking of that, the article that Tom Shanker had talks about how when the Soviet Union left, they had the foreign minister, that I'm sure Nazi, has suggested to have 10,000 to 15,000 staying there to sort of ensure that the security will prevail, that there will not be chaos or vacuum. But instead, with the collapse of the Soviet Union, everything went become chaotic. In the United States, there is a move towards leaving about 10,000 to 15,000. Are we following, are we doing it the right way that the Soviet Union at the time thought they were doing it?
I think the New York Times article by Shanker, it has major flaws, and the flaws are in the analogy. The analogy is that when the Soviets were leaving, they had no interest whatsoever in making sure that Afghanistan is at peace. Yeah. Instead, they want an Afghanistan embroiled in a civil war. So that they would not be a threat to their Central Asian republics. The United States' interests are the complete opposite. We want a peaceful Afghanistan so there is no second 9/11 or a blowback of one sort or another that will be a threat to the United States or the United States' interests in the region. So this is the first problem with his analogy. The second, and of course they often disregard the analysis of Afghans fearing that they would not have an objective perspective on the issue, but then they are missing a whole deal because they don't know the internal, the foreign analysts do not know the internal politics of the of Afghanistan. The other thing is that in the case of the Soviet Union, their foreign policy establishment, whatever that was under the Soviet system, along with the Red Army, the military side of it, there was no conflict. Whereas in the case of the United States, Oftentimes it has happened, like in two of the articles that I have written on my website, where the Pentagon undermines the diplomatic efforts of the State Department. Mm. So as much as the State Department wants to have a negotiation, some sort of a peace agreement in Afghanistan, that opportunity is lost because the Pentagon intervenes, because mm-hmm. peace has no dividend for the military. You don't get any medals by sitting at the table negotiating peace, but you gain medals by going to the battlefield.
We'll come back to that in a second. But Gerardo, I know we have only a few more minutes to go back. Gerardo wants to take us back to the issue of women's rights. He asks, or he comments, do you think women's rights in Afghanistan will completely disappear when the U.S. gets out?
I would ask Gerard the same question. Do you think that there was a burqa burning celebration when the United States went in? The state of the women's rights, civil rights in general, but the women's right, has not changed one bit, except in areas where they can create a facade. For instance, in the parliament, they have created a quota of having at least 25% of the membership for the women. For women deputies, which is a wonderful thing. But you talk to those 25% women, nobody listens to them. And in the presence of those 25% women, that same parliament that we have endorsed, that we have encouraged to bring to power, have passed laws that are so totally un-Islamic and uncivil, and discriminate against women, and I wouldn't go into the details of it. Mm. So the facade is there, but in reality, it's only, I would say, relative improvement. And if the United States leaves, the Afghan society would be able to take care of it, except that if we leave after we have righted the wrong. And as I said, the critical thing is that if the United States leaves as the situation is now, we will have a bloody civil war, probably worse than Rwanda, because the ethnic dimension is going to be activated by the regional powers that want to manipulate the crisis. The United States would not have any interest to go back, or stamina, or the Congress would not have any interest in going back, and Afghanistan would be left into its own demise. And in a country where the stability is not guaranteed, and you arm only one group as opposed to the rest, what is going to happen? Well, that's a formula for disaster.
Let me ask you straightforward, and we have only 2 or 3 minutes to finish this. The Shankar writes, quoting a professor, Mark Katz, the main thing the Soviets did right was that they continued large-scale military assistance to the regime. Am I hearing you to say that the only way for Afghanistan to remain, to avoid this crisis, is to the United States to get out in ways that would sort of even leave large-scale military? Would that be acceptable?
Any foreign presence in Afghanistan will not be accepted by the general public.
How would you do it? How would we?
Well, what they will do is they will use the puppet government, and the president of Afghanistan is coming next week to the United States. They will have plans to sign a treaty, an agreement with that government, but that government has no legitimacy.
That's the same thing they did with Iraq. Are you talking about the agreement?
Right. Yeah. So they will have, and the Soviets did the same thing with the regime that they had installed there.
Yeah.
So the thing is that is not going to last. Now, what will the consequences be? That's a little bit of a crystal ball. But the point is that if we want any stability, even a semi-legitimate government in Afghanistan can be left, so long as no group is left disenfranchised, so long as there is at least a modicum of a representation as far as the ethnic balance goes.
I have to let it there, Dr. Zaman Sanazai. It's a pleasure having you. It's always interesting.
Thank you for inviting me.
I'm honored. We come back to the end of our show. We covered some of the issues in international politics. We'll see you next week. And until then, keep studying. And don't forget to call us and to tune in at other programs on this Cal State Dominguez Hill station. Bye-bye.